when we want to get the negation of some, you know, P and Q or Q or Q. And also we have very basic, very simple, have a very simple example to double negation, so not P and P. And the third one is very useful because we find, well, if P then Q is equivalent to not P or Q, so this one, because they have the two, there are two values in corresponding rows in the truth table. Yeah, so the equivalent between this and this is very useful. Okay, so this is the second part about equivalence. Then we also several definitions. We have some statement which is always true, and so we call this one is tautology. And we also have some statement which is always false, so they are contradiction. And also if we have P then Q, then we have several transformation like converse, inverse, or contrapositive. And the important thing is our statement, our original statement is just equivalent to the contrapositive. And also we have proved some method for proving that we have defined some method for proving, which is called proof by contradiction. So this is the third part. Then we have, we want to represent statements in a more mathematical way, so we use quantifier. Quantifier, usually we have two main quantifiers. First is universal quantifier, second is existential quantifier. And then some statement can be represented by quantifier first and also then the predicate. Somehow we need to, you know, negate forward we are in this, so to get these two basic quantifiers. So we have this rule for this negating. And also if there are, you know, more than one quantifier in the statement, we have to apply the rules successively. So which means we deal in one quantifier at a time. So one by one. Okay, so the last part is about sets. So sets, we have basic definitions for sets, and also we have two basic operations for sets, so union and intersection. That's the basic definition for union and intersection. One more thing is we have the principle of inclusion and exclusion to help us get the size of the union of several sets. So that's the principle of inclusion and exclusion. And also we have a very powerful tool which is called Venn diagram to help us to, you know, to identify which to visualize the sets we are going to find or we are going to do the operation. So that's Venn diagram, a very powerful tool which has been used. Okay, so that's all about the review part. So final question. Right. Then we just move on to consider problems. So I think the first two are just warm up for our tutorial. So we have the first question is about we want to write down the negation of following two statements in English. So the first one is he is always not lying. He is not always lying. He may lie sometimes, so he sometimes lies. Right? The second one is he is not always lying. So he is not always lying. So the negation is he is always lying. So he is always lying. Right? So this is the first one. The second one is we want to get the converse and the contrapositive of the implication. So if every one of these traffic rules, then there will not be many accidents. So the converse is, if our original statement has a representation, like if P then Q, then the converse is there are not so many accidents that everyone is obeying traffic rules. And also the contraproductive is should be if not killed then shot be. So we need to deny or we need to get the negation of the two statements. So if there are so many accidents, then it must be that someone is not obeying traffic rules. So that's the converse and contrapositive in English. Any question? I think that's just a warm-up for the review. Alright, so the third one. We want to consider how we have these two basic basic statements, P and Q. P is a mushroom is purple, Q is a mushroom is green. So we want to express the following sentences using PQ and logical connectives. So that's it. So the first one is all purple mushrooms are poisonous, which means if a mushroom is purple, then according to the sentence, it is poisonous. So it's P. Thank you. The second one is different compared to the first one. A mushroom is poisonous only if it is purple. So here you need to consider that if a mushroom is purple, there may be some other reason for a mushroom to be poisonous. But if a mushroom is poisonous, then the mushroom should be purple. So it means if Q, then P. So that's the difference between omnaive and P. Okay, so, and the third one, the mushroom is not poisonous unless it is purple. So, which means it also, if a mushroom, this statement, this sentence not saying a mushroom is purple, then it is poisonous. It only say a mushroom is not purple, then mushroom cannot be even, so that's not be nice. If not be, then not true. Last one is no purple mushroom is poisonous. So which means if a mushroom is purple, then it cannot be poisonous. Okay, so that's P, then not true. But I have to say, those solutions are not unique because you can use the contrapositive to replace the original one. That's the one. Alright, so then we are going to consider this interesting problem. So we want to determine or to prove the equivalence between each pair of statements. So usually we have two ideas. So the first one is just apply the definition. The definition tells us that we have to use truth table to compare the truth values in the truth table. And then if they are all the same, then we say they are equivalent. If there is some difference there, then it is not equivalent. So this is the idea one. But I have to say we can also apply some similar equivalence. Equivalences like the first one we have proved by the truth table. The second one is from page 12 at lecture 3, and also we have Jerome's code. We can use those similar equivalences to transfer our original statement into some other form. So I just use examples to tell you why we have idea. So for the first one, first apply idea one, so use truth table. Okay, so we have P, Q, R, and first statement is P, Q, O, R. And P and Q. Alright, so for the truth table, we need to all cases. So first PQR. So we find this one should be choose and this one should be choose. And then choose here we already found some difference. We already find these, they are not the same, you know, in this row, so which means they are not individual. So like here, we already find some difference just by just at the second step, second row. So that's the first idea one. So how about we consider idea two? Okay, so we have these two statements. So the first one is this. So we use the first, this equivalence here. So this one is equivalent to, and I use this symbol to represent equivalent. So this one is equivalent to not P or for the full part. And then I can, according to this equivalent, if this equivalent here, if the connectives are all four, then we can shift the brackets from the last two terms to the first two terms. Okay, so we put it here. So we find the first element is equivalent to this statement, right? Then we can see the second one. Again, we can write it. First step is not P and Q or R. And then here we can use the Hogan's rule to get a different form. So here is not P or not Q or R. So here I use R, and we already this one is equivalent to this one, and also, which means this one just equivalent to this one, not P or not Q. So we find, well, for the problem subquestion B, we find these two statements are both equivalent to one same statement. So they are just equivalent to each other, because they are the same. Then the other, these two are equivalent. But if you use truth table to prove the equivalence between these two statements, then you need to write down a very big table, right? Because we have PQR here, and you need to extreme all cases until you cannot find any difference. Then you can, you know, draw the conclusion that they are equivalent to each other. So which means truth table here. So this is tedious. So if we use two symbols, then here it is tedious. Okay, so that's the benefits for our, you know, idea two. We just apply some similar equivalences, and if something like here, they are the same equivalent, they are the same statement, then our equivalence must be equivalent. Right, so we consider the last one. Last one first, this one P or not P, this one is just always very easy. And the first one is this. Okay, so it is equivalent to not P or Q or not Q or R. And we find all connectives are all here, so we can shift to the brackets. So we can shift brackets here. And we find inside these brackets, this one is always true. And we find these two are all here, so which means the total statement always true. So total statement always true. So this one is always true. So which means this one is also always true, and this one is always true. And so these two are equivalent to each other. Right? So that's idea two. We do not need to use truth table to get the equivalence. And any question about this kind of matter?
Can I ask something? So for this one question, right, is it only that you try to remove the arrow?
You try to remove the arrow?
Yeah, then change it to the all and simple.
You mean what? You mean here?
Yeah, here,
I don't know what you mean, sorry.
It's like, from the first impression that is given, is if P then Q or R.
Yeah.
Is it always that you must change it, that it does not consist of if and then? Then you compare.
Oh my.
So anyway, we can, because this one is very important, we can transfer any if then Q to not P or Q. So this one is very useful. Alright, so this is the solution for problem 4. Okay, so problem 5. Problem 5 is we are going to draw a Venn diagram for this set. So this set, we have AB first. So we say this left circle is A, this circle is B. Then A, the intersection between A and the complement of B. So complement of B is outside this circle. And A, so this is this red part, that red part. And this one is this right red part. So your union just you. So that's the red part. And how to describe it in logical meaning? So it's, we say this kind of is just exclusive or because you will find this part is just some exclusive of that B, and this part is exclusive of that A. So these two just exclusive of this. Okay, so this is the number five. Alright, so problem six. We are going to use quantifiers. Alright, the quantifiers. So we have a statement, there is no largest natural number. And we want to use quantifiers and predicate to represent this sentence in language of mathematics. So there is no largest natural number, which means if we are given any natural number, we can always find a larger one. Then it's just an equivalent to our there is no largest natural number. So we first transfer our original sentence to this equivalent sentence. So for any natural number, we can always find a larger natural number. Then for this sentence, we can easily write down the quantifiers and predicate. So for any, which means for any natural number n, we can always find some natural number n such that m is larger than n, is greater than n. So this is the quantifier representation for our sentence. So then we also need to find the negation written in English and in symbols. So in English, there is a largest natural number. And the symbol, so we want to negate these quantifiers. So we just do one by one. So the first one is any, then there exists. The second one is there exists, then for any. Actually, we need to do the step by step, but yeah. So the step by step is for any digit number n. There exists some digit number n such that n is less than n. Now we first step. We need to get the negation of the first quantifier. So first quantifier, the negation is there exists a natural number n, and we have to negate the whole part. So this is step one for the first quantifier. Step two for the second quantifier. So here inside this bracket should be for NA and in case this one so N greater than N or equal to N. So that's the negation of our total quantifiers. Okay, so step by step. Alright, so final question. Okay, so the last problem. So this one, we need to find number of integers between 1 and 1000, and they are satisfying some conditions. So the first step we need to use to represent those numbers by set. So I first say we use x n to represent the set of numbers, not set of integers. Between 1 and 1000.
is which are multipliers multiples of our energy.
Okay. So we have this. And for the first sub-question, we want to find all these integers which are multiples of 4, 5, or 6. So we first have 4 multiples of 4 and 4, 5, and 4, 6. So we want to find 4 here, so which are union of these three sets. And we want to get how many number of we want to get the number of integers, so just the size of this set. So here we want to get the size of the union of some sets. So here we can use principle of inclusion and exclusion. Okay, so this one is x4, size of x4, x5, x6, minus the section. We have to find the intersection, the size of intersections. So we can also find, well, if we have these two sets and we want to define the intersection. So their intersection should be some set we say is the least common. Okay, so we have defined the intersection of maybe xA and xB. Then we can write down the size. So for the size of x4, it should be, so we have 1,000 numbers, and 4 is like 250, so x5 should be 100. And x6 here, because we find this number is not an integer, and we find it cannot be 167, so it can only be, so this one can only be 166, plus this one is, well, maybe it's like this. Okay, so also we can find the size of their intersections. So this one is just x, and x20 is 50, and also x5, x6, x30. So x30 should be 3, and x6, x4. Yeah, this common multiple is 12. This one is 83. Yeah, and also the last one, x4, x5, x6. This one is x16, and this one is. Okay, so we have find all values for those terms in the formula. So we just plug the values into the formula. Okay, then you write down, calculate, compute the solution. So the solution just give you is 466. Okay, so this is problem. First sub question. Second one, we want to find multiples of at least 2 or 4, 5, or 6. So 2, so it can be a multiple of 4 or 5, or multiple of 5 or 6, or 6 or 7, 6 or 4. And we want to find multiple of at least 2. So we can represent this set by the union of these three centers. And also we want to find the size of this union. So again, it's PIE. So this one is and all intersections are just intersection between 4, 5, and 6, and the last one is also this one. Okay, so as we have computed here, we already know the values, so we plug the values into the formula, we can take out solution. The solution should be 1, 3, 4. Okay, so this is sub-2. Then the third one. Third one here, we better use a Venn diagram to tell us. So we say, we denote each circle as x4, x5, x6. And we want to find the multiples of exactly 1 of 4, 5, 6. So exactly 1 is just this, the union of these three parts. This red one, the red part is just the set we are going to get the size of multiples of exactly 1 of 4, 5, or 6. So we want to get the size of red part. So how to get the size of red part? Luckily we have computed we have done the problem subquestion 1 and subquestion 2. We find subquestion 1 is just the union of the three circles. So the total part is the union. And the problem subquestion 2 given the size of this blue part. So inside the blue part is just a multiple of at least 2 or 4, 5 or 6. So this one is just a total part. Total part is from first subquestion. So 4, 6, 6. So here is from first subquestion. And minus the blue part. Blue part is from our second subquestion. So we can either write down the answer should be 3, 3. Okay, so this is subquestion 3. We use Venn diagram to help us to identify identify the set we are going to get the size. And then also use Venn diagram, we find this relationship and we can either write down this. Okay, so the last subquestion. Again, Venn diagram is very helpful here. So we have x, we have multiples of 16, but we need to exclude this set. So we find actually x16 should be in this part. Because first x16 should be totally included by x4, but it can also have some intersection with x6 and x5. So it should be at this part. Okay, so we need to exclude this x. We need to exclude this part. So how do we exclude this part? Just the total part, the total size minus the size of x16, right? So then the answer should be the total size. Total size is 4, 6, 6, and minus the size of x16. So x16 should be 62. 7. And that's all for today's tutorial. Any question? Horrible for any size of it.